showroom on the table right there. So if you would like to make a donation or an offering to Alpha Pregnancy Center, please just leave it right there in that box, and all the proceeds will go to Alpha Pregnancy Center. If there are no other announcements that I missed, we will proceed with the call to worship. So please rise out of reverence for the Word of God. We will read Matthew 8:11. I tell you, many will come from east and west and recline at table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. Matthew 8:11. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray together. Again, Lord, we thank you so much for waking us all up, for sustaining the breath of life in each and every one of our bodies. Lord, you keep us moving, you keep us going. Our bodies work the way they should because you sustain us, Lord. The ground remains solid under our feet because you uphold it. Lord, the sky does not collapse on us because you keep it on its pillars. Lord, you are our God, you are our creator, our sustainer. And Father, you sent your son to die because we rebelled against you. And yet, you loved us so much that you decided to save worthless sinners such as myself. So we thank you for that. And we pray earnestly and dearly this morning that our hearts would be devoted to you, that they would rest in you, and Lord, that what the pittance we could give back in return would be glorifying and honoring and pleasing to you. And so I do pray earnestly for all those who have made it today and ask that you would again inspire them and, Lord, keep your spirit strong and fervent within us and help us to glorify your name in Jesus' name.
Good morning, Saints. Good morning. I hope you're enjoying this beautiful weather. Seems like you're not, so. Are you enjoying this beautiful weather?
Yes.
All right, that sounds much better. As we continue to serve the Lord, let us sing this song together as we worship Him this morning. It is hymn 331. And the title of the song is Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart. I hope your heart is strong enough, because when the Lord descends on you, then He makes you move.
reason. The Apocrypha is that portion of writing that many denominations, Roman Catholics, Episcopals, and some others include pieces of it, but it's a group of writings that we do not consider canon, but it's very important to us to understand why we do not consider it canon. It's also very important to understand that there's pieces of it we can actually learn things from. This week he's going to be doing the books of the Maccabees. Now there's 400 years before the close of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament. Okay, between the last writing of Malachi and the angel appearing. Okay, that 400 years is called the 400 silent years. The books of the Maccabees help us to get some insight into how things went from being under, you know, the control of Cyrus of Persia, to all of a sudden they're under the control of Rome. How'd that happen? Well, what he's going to do this week on Wednesday night, he's going to explain some of that to us far more than we could ever do in a week. But if you're ever thinking about coming to one specific night of a Wednesday night, let me bait you into it a little bit. Okay? This has been great stuff that Pastor Sean has been bringing us. He puts a lot into that. So that's a piece of that. Our prayer requests, you notice Melissa is missing. The prayer request went out last night. She has pneumonia. She's on medication. She's doing better, you said, Henry? Right. So Melissa for pneumonia. Lynette is still missing. Pneumonia. Barb is missing. She's had cataract surgery, and I guess I can't get it because I've never had it done, but I understand that when you've had one eye done, it's a mess to try to, Diana's telling me yes, it's a mess. So we got to pray for Barb. She gets the other one done Tuesday. We expect we'll see her back Wednesday night. Both eyes working. We'll expect that all to be working. The Santarella family as a group continue to pray for the Santarella family. Having lost Liz this past week, they had a funeral for her, and that was, you know, some of our folks were able to attend that. And just continue to be with the entire team of the Santarella family. She was a very special lady, and I'm just going to leave that right there. We've all lost family, and it's a suffering time, and we all grieve differently. So as they grieve, be with them as they grieve, which is what I'm going to ask. So before I do anything else, though, because I'm going to include Alpha Pregnancy in my morning prayer, I'm going to ask Jenny Monaster to come up and join us and deliver up to us the message that she has, that God has given to her, to bring to us this morning. Come on up, Jenny. Thanks for coming.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's always nice to be back. You guys are always so welcoming, so you make me feel more comfortable. And if you were here last year, you know that public speaking is not something comes very naturally to me. So, again, I have notes because I don't want to be nervous and forget anything. And I'm just noticing Christine behind me. Good morning. So the biggest update I have for this year is, as your pastor's already made mention, is I'm now the center director. Lindsay is the development director. We were noticing that there's just an increased need for event planning, donor relations, fundraising, stuff like that. So she has been promoted to that position, and she is doing amazing. So I'm really excited and happy for her, and that kind of paved the way for me to be able to step up to center director, which I'm really excited for as well. Lindsay also gets to work with all five centers now, so that's really exciting for her as well. And I briefly wanted to share my vision for the Amsterdam Center. I want to make sure that everyone who comes through our doors feels valued and loved. I want them to know that start up in the beginning of June, actually. We had a volunteer who came to us. She's a lovely woman, and she has expressed interest in teaching parenting classes. So we're going through the training process with her. So she can hopefully hit the ground running in the beginning of June. So you guys can all be aware about that. Another update that I wanted to share is Albany County tried passing a bill called Local Law D. I don't know if anybody has heard of that. But basically, just a condensed version of what that bill is, they were asking us to put up signs referring for abortion, and they wanted us to make referrals for abortion, and that we would be fined for infractions. And we were also being accused of giving out false information, and a lot of really nasty negative stuff was being said about us, which wasn't true. So we got a heads up from a legislator who is sympathetic to our cause, and said, hey, I don't know if you guys are aware of this, and we're very grateful to him because we were able to kind of come up with a game plan. And we showed up and spoke at committee meetings, and we actually went as far as Lindsay, actually. I could give her a lot of credit. She was fantastic. She called almost 30 legislators in Albany County and invited them to take tours of our center and come speak with us directly. Instead of believing the negative things that were said about us, we encourage them to come talk with us directly so we can tell you what it is we do and what it is we don't do. So, unfortunately, most did not take us up on that offer. We did have a few that did show. We're very thankful for them. A couple were not so nice to Lindsay on the phone, so we'll just put it that way. The latest update that I've gotten from my executive director is that the law has been tabled for now. I think we surprised them that we knew and we gave them some pushback, and we don't know what will happen with it in the future. It hasn't completely been demolished in a long way, but for now it's been tabled, and we're encouraged by that. So we just ask that you keep us in your prayers for that topic in particular. And finally, I just want to touch on a client story. It's always encouraging to me to hear all the things that are going on about this, especially the ones that are affecting clients. And I want to be very careful to protect her confidentiality and her identity, so I'm not going to share specifics, and I'm not going to share her name. But I am going to give you a general snippet of her story, because I find it very encouraging. And when I was thinking and praying about what to say to you guys today, I really felt strongly that I wanted to share about her story, because it's impacted me personally this last year in particular. So this specific client came to us in August of 2022, and she had custody of and was caring for a child and needed help. She has significant trauma in her life, especially as a child. That trauma has a way of affecting you in your adult life. It's definitely inhibiting her from living her full potential of Christ, for sure. And she especially has a hard time. She grew up Catholic, and she has a hard time reconciling her trauma with God. As far as her making a declaration of faith, we've had many conversations with her. She's had lots of questions, and her trauma has been a huge obstacle in her way. And when she first came to us, her behavior was all over the place. You know, sometimes she was great, other times she was really difficult to deal with. She had a temper in many areas of her life. She would behave and speak in anger. In fact, in the beginning, when I first joined Alpha and met her, we would kind of have to like mentally prepare ourselves for what we knew she was coming in, because she could be difficult many
prayers for Bob. We love them both. They're great parts of our church community. We miss them when they're not here. We're also very happy to have Emma back with us. She got up on the ice for training, and there was a storm coming in, and I guess they decided they didn't want the training to be that real, so they brought them off the ice. We're glad to have you on the same time. So those are things that I'll be praying for, along with praying for Alpha Pregnancy, our normal morning prayer. Let's go to prayer.
I just want to say continue to pray for Lynn Fry. She did have her hip replacement surgery. As long as she sits in her easy chair, she's comfortable when she has to get off the back, changes. But her son and daughter are tag teaming each other to be with her, so she's not alone. And she's in good spirits. And she thanks us all so much for the prayers.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for all you are. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for the way you pour your blessings out upon us. Lord, we thank you for the things going on at Alpha Pregnancy. We thank you for this one young woman whose story was just shared. And we pray that this story is going to come to a conclusion, or not conclusion, but come to a major change point. As she hears your word and she is taught from your word, and she will come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ just by the basis of the word that he shared with her. We pray that that happens soon, sooner rather than later. We thank you that this local law 8 from Albany County was tabled. We pray it stays on the table or even gets taken off the table and thrown in the trash. We pray that it is never brought to legislature again. We ask that you continue to bless the work of Alpha Pregnancy for Lindsay, who we know and love, in her position in Albany, and now for Jenny in her position as the local face of Alpha. We do pray that you will bless the work that these women do, and that we will hear more stories as we have them back again to get reports. We'll hear another story of another great transformation in the lives of a woman. Lord, we pray this because it's one person at a time coming to you. That's how we expand the kingdom of God. So we ask your blessing on all those things. And for our own congregation, Lord, we have many missing this morning. There's Bob and his recovery. We pray that you will be with him as he recovers, Mindy, as she cares for him, as well as the children, who are being very, very attentive to the matter. We thank you for that. And if we are needed to provide anything, Lord, we pray that Mindy will reach out to us and we will be able to provide that. We ask you to be with Barb as she prepares for yet the second cataract surgery, and pray that we'll see her again real quickly. And we pray for Lynette that she will be totally clear of the pneumonia that she has, and be able to be back with us soon. We pray the same for Melissa. She was wise in not wanting to contaminate anyone this morning because she's not that far along in her med program yet. We pray that you will give her comfort this morning. We pray that you will give her peace. We pray that you will give her relief of the symptoms, and do that all very soon. We pray for the entirety of the Santorella family as they deal with the loss of the grandmother. We all grieve differently, we understand that, and each within the family grieves differently, we understand that. So be with them, comfort them, give them joy in their lives, and give them joy in the memory of their grandma, who loved them, and who they loved. Lord, we thank you for Lynn Fry's successful surgery. We pray that she will recover quickly, and you be with her family as they attend her as well. And Father, now as we turn our direction of our service and we go into more of a worshipful portion, we pray that we will now, as you have blessed us, we will in turn give back a portion of those blessings, the material blessings that you've given us. We will return a portion of that to you here in the form of our offering. We pray, Lord, that whatever is given is used well, is used wisely for your honor, for your glory, for the sake of your kingdom.
song, you know, because of the words and because of our personal relationship with God. It just expresses, oh God, died on the cross for us. You know, just giving up everything for us. And we all can relate to this song.
Lord, my God,
44. While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this wonderful saga of chapter 10 of the book of Acts. We thank you, Lord, for its infallibility. We thank you for the lessons that are there for us yet today, all these years later. Open our hearts, open our eyes, illumine us as we go into your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The gospel of Jesus Christ had come, finally, to the Gentiles. There had been a process. We had been watching since the beginning of chapter 10 this collision of two worlds. We had been watching it happen. We've been watching the process of transformation that occurred within Peter that brought him to the point of going, "All right, Lord, I get it. I'll talk with the Gentiles." And then we see how the Gentile world was being prepared. This man named Cornelius, centurion in Caesarea, had a vision and said, "Go get this guy named Peter. He has a message for you." And Peter came along with a few men from Joppa, and they came, and this is the grand finale, so to speak, of this point. This is the reconciliation between Jews and Gentiles. The people who had been God's people and the people who were not God's people are now all God's people. Last week, Pastor Sean dropped the thought, if not the word, of reconciliation in his message. He set me up for exactly where I was planning to go. And that plan involves another passage of Scripture. I'm going to ask you, if you wish to do so, turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2. I'm going to read 11 to 16. I'm going to highlight just a few things up on the board that you'll see that just probably more than half of it's going to wind up there. I'm just going to ask you, if you'd like to follow along, please do so. "Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision, by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at the time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two. We really have now no more Jews, no more Gentiles. We have the people who were not God's people, the people who were God's people now are all God's people." And having put that in our background or in our mind this morning, this concept of reconciliation, we will begin to unpack our morning text. We start with the arrival of the Holy Spirit. event sometime later where the Holy Spirit fell in power on the Samaritans, kind of a half-breed of Jews, kind of a half-breed, but they had been evangelized by Philip the Evangelist, and now they had trusted Christ, and now the Holy Spirit fell on them, and now we're getting to this third Pentecost with the Gentiles. We're going to note that these are all exceptional events, and these are not the way we see things happen in the church this morning. It's not the way we see things happen in the church today. As a matter of fact, throughout the rest of the book of Acts, we didn't see things happen quite in these ways. And however, the Holy Spirit is present. The Holy Spirit is present in the world, has been present in the world since creation, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters.
Yeah,
that's the Holy Spirit. He's been present since creation. The Old Testament, he empowered individuals, different times, different events. In the New Testament time, all believers have the New Testament. I'm sorry, all believers, since in this New Testament time, gain the Holy Spirit at the time of our conversion. But we'll develop that a little bit later. Not this morning. Okay, the first thing we're going to notice here, the first piece, it's critical though, that these events happened while Peter was still speaking, while Peter was still saying these things, the way the quote is from the text. Now, interestingly, being Baptists, we have this process we use. We like to have a nice 3, maybe 4 point sermon, and I'm a great one for alliterating. There's things we do. Peter never did any of that. Peter never got around to calling for repentance. He never got around to calling for the sinner's prayer. The Holy Spirit interrupted him. What a terrible thing. Okay? The Holy Spirit can do that. Okay? The Holy Spirit has the power and certainly has the privilege to do that. But Peter just kept on preaching and the Spirit came. We're also going to note there that it says, all who heard. And it's entirely possible, and I think it's a preferred reading and understanding of the original language, all who heard, that means as many who were in that room, I don't know whether there were a dozen, I don't know whether it was 25, we don't know how many people were there, but we do know, and I mentioned this in a previous message, they came expectantly. They came to hear something from the mouth of God. And as Peter opened his mouth, delivering the words of God, they heard it, and as many as heard it, believed. And this was saving faith. And with saving faith came the outpouring of the Spirit. When we are saved today, we do not get this visible effect. We don't get that. But we do get the Holy Spirit. And he empowers us to do things that are far above our own abilities. As we read this text, we can get in trouble when we start reading about the believers who came from Joppa. They were seeing them, hearing them, speaking in tongues and extolling God. This is where we can scratch our heads. This is where we can argue with other believers who believe differently than we do. Please don't argue with them. Understand that they have a different understanding. There is my understanding, and this is the vast majority of those who believe within the Baptist realm. Okay, there is no need to think of this as the outpouring of an ecstatic language, which means the speaking in tongues as we hear it, you know, we hear the term used. The original language does not require it to be a language totally unknown. It only requires that it be a language unknown to the people who are speaking it. For instance, I had an event one time where I communicated in a three-way conversation in Spanish. I didn't speak Spanish. I spoke English to a guy who couldn't speak English, and he spoke in Spanish to a guy who could only speak Spanish. I understood everything that went on. I couldn't to speak the Spanish. Okay. That is, if you want technical terms, I'll talk to you later about what that is. Okay. But it's, that's the kind of thing I believe this was. And it says other tongues. Now, I'm going to submit to you my thought here. The people who came from Joppa were Jewish believers. They had been converted from Judaism to Christianity. And Peter was himself a devout Jew. They would have known the Hebrew language. The people they were talking to, this group in Caesarea, would not have known the Hebrew language. Just suppose, and I'm putting this out, I'll call this sanctified speculation. I'll put this out there for this. Just suppose they started speaking in Hebrew. And they recited the Shema. The Lord your God is one. Just suppose that was what came out of their mouths. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Makes me lie down in green pastures. Just suppose that came out in Hebrew. That would have been something totally unknown to their culture. And now they're reciting it, extolling God in a language that was not their language. That would have certainly accounted for the amazement of the believers. These men from Joppa went on, wow, this is something really interesting that's happening here. We've never seen anything like this before. And they would have been taken by storm by this. It would have been a sure sign of the Holy Spirit working here. We had the display in Jerusalem. We had the display in Samaria. The Samaritans, you can say, well, at least they kind of had the law. At least they kind of, you know, the men were circumcised. And these people, no, they had nothing. They didn't have the law. The men weren't circumcised. It's referenced in here. Those who were called, it was in the text I read from Ephesians. That was not part of their life. This was something brand new, and when the believers saw it, they were totally amazed. Would have been a major lesson, an eye-opening event for them. And then Peter would direct those men to the administration of the ordinance. Only one. We only believe in two ordinances. Okay? We have the ordinance of baptism. We have the ordinance of the Lord's Supper. They are both ordinances of obedience. There is nothing there that has any saving force in either one. We do not believe, like some churches do, that to be baptized removes original sin. We cannot find that anywhere in Scripture. I want to be surely clear on that. Baptism is an act of obedience, nothing more. To take the Lord's Supper is an act of obedience and participation in the worldwide church. Nothing more. There's no saving effect of either. So Peter asked them the question, can anyone withhold water? And this is a rhetorical question. It's put out there in such a way that they say, no, we can't do that. We can't withhold water. We have to get this done now. The answer should have been obvious to the men. And it appears that they just went out and did that. They were probably being in Caesarea. They were close to the Mediterranean Sea. They would have gone right to the sea, and they would have done it right there. And there's that matter of baptism into the name of Jesus Christ. If you pick that from the text, you'll find that there may be a bit of a problem. We'll get into that in just a minute. Fifth century bishop named Chrysostom, he says this. By giving the Spirit to Cornelius and his household before the baptism, God gave Peter a mighty reason or justification for giving them water baptism. Peter was clear that in no one point was he the author of his baptism, but in every point it was God. It's as if Peter said, God baptized them, not I. But within this whole little process and this little piece of the story, there's this thing that makes us go, In the Great Commission, Jesus said, make disciples of all nations, and then he says, baptizing them in Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. under the authority of Jesus Christ. Whether the words were said specifically or not, and I don't know that they were or were not, we're not given that in the text, we see that these people were God seekers. They came to hear a word from God. So we have the Father. They were brought to a knowledge of the Son in Peter's very short message. And then the Spirit showed up in power. So whether the words were spoken or not, we have Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The baptism was certainly complete. And then they asked for additional training. The group wanted additional teaching, and they wanted it now. They didn't want to let go of these guys. I love it when a new believer says, I've got to spend some time with you, or I've got to spend some time, who can I talk to? What can I learn? Where can I read? What can I listen to? This is what the attitude of a believer should be. Okay? To want additional teaching. They have the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit will, Scripture tells us, guide us into all truth. They needed to have the conversation and to be taught by people who had been living the Christian life for some period of time up to that point. It would be a more practical means of teaching. We're not told how long they stayed. We have no idea. And if we think back to last week, Pastor Sean, with a bit of that sanctified speculation of his own, he put out the path, the possibility that these people may have been the origin of what we still see in the Palestinian church. We still have a mass of Palestinian believers, and the understanding it comes from the earliest of Christians in Palestine. Well, guess what? These were the very first believers in Palestine. I think Pastor John's on to something with that thought. So if this is an offshoot, that time was well spent. Because we still have believers yet today in Palestine that are not the result of any recent or fairly recent missionary endeavors that we know of. But what we have here is the completion of the reconciliation. First of all, Christ died to reconcile sinful man to a holy God. And now we have the event occur that reconciled Jews and Gentiles. We have Jewish believers teaching Gentile believers. What we have is brothers teaching brothers. What a wonderful example of reconciliation we have there. So what are our takeaways here? The first thing is give the gospel. That's what Peter was doing. He just began to give the gospel in the context of the day, in the context of how he got there. Paul tells the Roman church, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed, and how are they to believe in him in whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? Preaching need not be complex. This was a pretty simple. Of the sermons we have from Peter's, this was the simplest sermon he gave. He put the message of the gospel, that Christ died for the sins of man, he put that message into the context of the day, and just let the word of God speak to them in that. We've learned to do the same thing that way. Second thing is to let the Spirit do its work. The Spirit proves the validity of the one who has faith. May not look today like it looked then. We do not expect tongues of fire to fall down upon us. Okay? But it should be obvious when we see the fruit of the Spirit in someone. Galatians chapter 5, 19 and following, I'm just going to summarize it with just a handful of words. We see the behaviors of the men without the Spirit, the man or woman without the Spirit of God. The works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like this. there's 19 specific things, and then the list goes on. I like to use ellipses when I write, just kind of what was done here when Paul wrote the Galatians. The list goes on. But the fruit of the Spirit. And here he just names some that encapsulate the behaviors that are endemic, shall I say, to those people who have the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. So things that are such things, those are the fruits of the Spirit, or the fruit of the Spirit. I do believe it is meant to be an inclusive one-word fruit of the Spirit. And there is participation in the ordinance. We only have two, as I said before. We have baptism, and that is baptism by immersion. And that is a believer's baptism. We do not believe baptize someone who does not express faith in Jesus Christ. We also do not baptize people who are blatantly living in rebellion to God's word. I had a young man come in a couple of weeks ago on Monday afternoon. He called me and spoke to us, left a message on the phone, wanted me to baptize him, wanted to talk to me about baptizing him. So he came in, and we had a nice conversation. And in the course of the conversation, I explained to him what we believe, and I believe he has a concept of salvation. I'm not sure he's there. But he has a glaring issue of rebellion and sin in his life. And so I'm not going to baptize you. Deal with that, and come back and we'll have the conversation. But I'm not going to baptize someone who is in rebellion. If you're not repenting, you're not going to get baptized. I'm in this church. Maybe he found somebody else who will do it. I don't know. The Lord's Supper is also part of the Christian lifestyle. We're given guidelines from Paul in 1 Corinthians on when to take or not to take communion, the Lord's Supper. And if we were having the Lord's Supper today, I would expound on that a little more. Bottom line is the same thing. If you're in blatant rebellion, you don't want to take communion. Okay? It's an act of obedience. If you're being obedient here and disobedient elsewhere, this is not the place you want to be. You want to get the rest of it straightened out first. Okay? And then there's participation in additional teaching. Either as a student or as a teacher. There's opportunities for both things. There are plenty of opportunities to be taught. Even for myself as a pastor, trust me, I have to be taught. Pastor Sean has to be taught. We still need to go for additional teaching and training when we have the opportunity to get it. Okay? There may be times when it may surprise you, you may be called upon to be the teacher. Anybody here be surprised if you got all of a sudden called upon to be a teacher? I know there was somebody I called upon that asked if you'd like to lead a certain class one time. You got it? And unfortunately, that's a reality. Well, Peter said, no, I'm not going to go teach those people. No, I got someplace else today. I don't want to be here. I've been here, I brought you to Christ, saw the Holy Spirit come upon you, I'm out of here. What if you wouldn't say and teach? Just drop that in the back of your mind and think about that. In order to teach, we must first of all know the gospel. Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. Any who calls upon him can be saved. All who call upon the name of the Lord can be saved. And know that there's no other way that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through him. Okay, we have to know those things. We have to be able to explain those things. And we have to be able to contextualize it. And I say that just in two ways. And then I'm really kind of wrapping it up. There are people who really don't have a concept of eternity. And when you're telling them the gospel, eternity is not what's on their mind. You know what's on their mind? Day-to-day life. Day-to-day life is tough. It's tougher for some of us than it is for others. Some of us have all kinds of problems, work problems. The young lady you described, Jenny. Her life is tough. The context. she needs is the love of Christ. It's still the love of Christ, but the context is his love and how he gives the peace that passes all understanding. And then there's others who are at the end of their life, maybe they know that. I've twice been to men's bedsides, given them the gospel, and praise God, I believe both of them made decisions for Christ, and I'll see them in heaven. I really believe that to be true. So, the context, there's all kinds of things in between where giving the gospel and seeing some response. And we must be able to present it and present it in context. Go back to that verse. How then will they call upon him in whom they have not believed, and how are they to believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? Peter's message was quite simple. He put it in the context, we need to learn to do the same. If you do not know Jesus Christ, know him today. It's not rocket science. We can do it so easily by merely trusting him, his finished work on the cross, for our sins, to pay the penalty for our sins. After that, it's learning how to explain that. This is what Jesus did for me. As is often said, there's nothing more than one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. That is the simple nature of the gospel. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that as we wrap up this account of Peter and his journey to Caesarea, all of the little complexities that you put in place to make this happen, Father, we thank you for all of that. And we thank you that your word is still simple. Your gospel still saves. And you still provide the peace that passes all understanding. As we bless the rest of our day here today, in Jesus' name.
You are your spirit, bring Father.
see the flames of the Spirit, but we should feel the heat within us as he occupies us, as he fills us, as he empowers us to give your word. Let us never fail to give, as Peter said, a reasoned defense for the hope that lies within us. Father, bless us through this week. Keep us safe. Return us again with your blessing.